Well, good morning, everyone, and I hope everybody is well this morning. And for anybody who is listening in today who doesn't normally come to our church or hasn't listened in before, you are very, very welcome, and it is great to have you with us. And the same applies if you're somebody who's watching it later in the week on YouTube. We're very glad that you have been able to join us. You are most welcome. And we do hope that before too long, we'll be able to have services back in the chapel. And if you live in Reach and you don't normally go to a church, you would always be more than welcome to come to services when we're back in the chapel, and we would look forward to meeting you. It is Father's Day today, and I want to you to think for just a moment, because you know, I loved my dad very much. Sadly, he's no longer with us and hasn't been for some time, but I loved him very much and I had a great relationship with him. And I love being a dad as well. I may not be that great at it, but I love being a dad. And for all of us watching, you will either have the experience of being a dad or the experience of having a dad. And for some of you, it may be that your experience of having a dad wasn't actually a great one. But I want you to know two things this morning, that Psalm 68, verse 5, the writer says that God is a father to the fatherless. And whatever your experience of your dad's or being a dad is, that God is your father, a father to the fatherless. And in Romans chapter 4, verse 11, Paul wrote that God is the father of all who believe. And so whoever you are this morning, whatever your experience is, that today we can celebrate, because the God is the father of all who believe and a father of the fatherless. He is our Father in heaven, not with any fault, not with any mistakes that our own parents would have made and that we would have made as parents. You know, you learn as you go along, don't you, as a parent? But God never makes a mistake. And he is your father today, your perfect father in heaven today. As we're on mute, I would like us to say the Lord's Prayer. And stay muted. That means that you can say whichever version that you prefer to say. But they begin with those wonderful words, Our Father. So let's say that this morning. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to listen to a song. You may want to sing along to this one, because this is one we've sung in church sometimes, and you will know this. Father God, I wonder.
Father God, I wonder how I managed to exist without the knowledge of your parenthood and your loving care. Now I am your son, I am adopted in your family, and I can never be alone. 'Cause Father God, you're there beside me.
Sing your praises,
got. I wonder how I managed to exist without the knowledge of your parenthood and your loving care. Now I am your son, I am adopted in your family, and I can never be alone, 'cause Father God, you're there beside me.
Father God, this morning we will sing your praises, because it's by your grace that we are here. We are children of yours, children of the living God, and you are our Father in heaven. And we do worship you and we praise you, because your name is a great name, and it is the name above all other names. No matter what we see going on in the world, no matter the evil people that we see at work, yours is the name above all other names, and we worship you this morning because you are our Father in heaven, and we are adopted in your family, and we thank you so much for that wonderful privilege. And we thank you too that you are a father to the fatherless, and so that for every single one of us, no matter who we are or where we're from, what colour we may be, whatever we may have done, wherever we may live, you are our Father. And we bow down before you this morning as children of yours, children of the living God. And we do lift to you this morning those who feel alone, those who feel that their experience of their own earthly dad was not a great one, those who may have recently lost him. May they know that you are a father to the fatherless. May they know just what that means to them. May we know what that means for us too. What a great thing it is Lord, we pray for all of those who are lost and lonely this morning. May they know your fatherhood to them and just what it means to them and for them. Amen. At this moment, I'm going to hand over to Rosemary, who's just going to talk for just a moment.
Okay. Hello. I've forgotten. Sorry. I've had in my mind, Peter and I've been sort of talking about it, doing a short series on Zoom about forgiveness, and it would basically be three parts: God's forgiveness of us, our forgiveness of others, and our forgiveness of ourselves. Now, it's in the early stages of development, so it's suitable for Zoom, but if you're interested, please let me know and it'll make it worthwhile me developing it and doing something about it. Thank you.
Okay, so forgiveness is such a major part of the Christian life. You know, God's forgiveness of us, our forgiveness of other people, and perhaps what we, many of us, find most difficult, our forgiveness of ourselves. And when we don't forgive ourselves, we are we're not taking fully the forgiveness of God, because we are still carrying that guilt and shame that shouldn't be there anymore, because Jesus died so that we might be forgiven. And so I think that this would be a really good thing that Rosemary is doing. And it may be that there are some of you there thinking, yeah, I really need that. I need to learn about forgiveness and perhaps to work through one or two things as well. So if that's you, then do get in touch with Rosemary. And Cheryl is going to bring us our reading this morning.
The reading today is from John chapter 7, verses 33 to 44. Jesus said, "I am with you only a short time, and then I will go to the one who sent me. You will look for me, but you will not find me. And where I am, you cannot come." The Jews said to one another, "Where does this man intend to go that we cannot find him? Will he go where our people live, scattered among the Greeks, and teach the Greeks? What did he mean when he said, 'You will look for me, but you will not find me, and where I am, you cannot come'?" On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, "If the man is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him." By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. On hearing his words, some of the people said, "Surely this man is a prophet." Others said, "He is the Christ." Still others asked, "How can the Christ come from Galilee? Does not the scripture say that the Christ will come from David's family and from Bethlehem, the town where David lived?" Thus the people were divided because of Jesus. Some wanted to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him.
Thank you, Cheryl. So we've been going through John's Gospel. And if you remember that Jesus has gone to the Feast of the Tabernacles, which was a feast which all Jewish men were expected to attend. And so everyone was expecting Jesus to be there. And people were arguing about who he is. And we talked about that last week. And we find that they are still arguing here. And one of the things they say is that we know where he's come from, and but the Son of God, the Messiah, wasn't going to come from there. And that's in verses 41 to 43. How can the Christ come from Galilee? And does not the scripture say that Christ will come from David's family and from Bethlehem, the town where David lived. And that's referring to the book of Micah in the Old Testament, chapter 5, verse 2, where it's prophesied that that's where the Messiah will come from. And these people don't know that that's where Jesus was born. And so that is one of the 333 prophecies that Jesus did fulfill, but they're arguing on this case because they don't realize that that's where he was born. In the end, what's happened is that people are sent to arrest him. The Pharisees have got a bit fed up and they realize that people are recognizing who Jesus is, and they're concerned by that. And so they've sent the guards to come and to arrest him in verse 32. And it comes to this, what's called the last and greatest day of the feast, verse 37. Now, this was an interesting day, and it would have been for all of those people who were there on this occasion. In fact, it would have been absolutely electric, because the last and the greatest day of the festival was when the Jews did two things. The first thing was they celebrated the day when they went into the promised land. When they'd been wandering in the wilderness, they were having to be fed miraculously with the manna that came down from heaven and the water that came out of the rock. And they needed that to be fed miraculously because there was nothing around for them. And every day God fed them and gave them water. And they are on this last and greatest day of the festival, they are celebrating when they went into the promised land, and they no longer needed to be have their thirst quenched or given food miraculously. They no longer needed that because they were in the promised land and there was food and water all around them, and they had plenty. And so they were celebrating that day that they went into the promised land. But it was also the day when they prayed for the coming Messiah. They prayed that the one would come who would fulfill all of those prophecies that are there in the Old Testament. And Jesus chooses this day to hit them with both barrels. Because when he stands up and speaks, people start to recognize, oh my goodness, this is him. This is the one who we should be praying for the coming of today. This is him, and people are recognizing that. But also Jesus talks on this day when they're celebrating, the day they no longer needed to be given water miraculously. Jesus is saying, now come to me and you won't be thirsty, because I will give you the living water, fill you with the Holy Spirit, the living water. And your lives will change. And so the two things that this day is all about, Jesus stands up and says this. Now, this would have been an absolute bombshell to people there. They would have been thinking, oh my goodness, this is it. This is what this day is all about. And the atmosphere would have been absolutely electric. I can't imagine what it would have been like for those people who accepted this, who recognized this is who Jesus is. He is the one that has been promised for so long. The one we're supposed to be praying for to come today. He's here right now in front of us. And he's promising us that living water. Now, in John chapter 4, verse 13, if you remember, that's where Jesus is by the well, and he's gone through Samaria, and which is a place where the Samaritans were hated by the Jews, and Jesus is there by the well, and he's speaking to a woman, which would have been very unusual. And he says, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. He's saying the same thing to a Samaritan woman that he's saying to the Jews. And what Jesus is promising is that he can supply the living water, the Holy Spirit. If you come to him, you'll be filled with the living water, the Holy Spirit. And the message is the same whether you are a Samaritan or whether you are a Jew. The message is the same. Come to me, he's saying, as you can be filled with the living water, the Holy Spirit, and you will never thirst again. And it doesn't matter who you are. It does not matter where you are from. It does not matter what you look like, whatever color or creed you may be. This message is for you. Do you know, I remember growing up in the days where you would see pictures of South Africa and riots going on during the days of apartheid back in the 70s and 80s. And there were many really good churches there and good Christian leaders, but there were churches that were segregated according to race, so that you, if you were not white, you could not go there. And yet the message of Jesus is that his love, his living water, is for everyone, and there is no segregation. The message is the same for every one of us, and it's the same for you out there now. Whoever you may be, that Jesus is saying, come to me, because I want to give you the living water. And by saying, come to me, Jesus is not saying, it's a whole lot stronger than saying, well, do you know, I've got this living water. If you fancy it, then pop along and see me. Or, do you know, I've got this living water. I mean, is anybody bothered? Jesus is saying, come to me, because he's excited about this, because his loving nature wants to give this living water to everyone. And he is saying, come to me. I want you to come to me. And this may be something that you have never heard before, because Jesus is saying, don't just come to church. Come to me. Don't just pick up your Bible from time to time and then put it down again and forget what you've read. Come to me. It may be that you're someone who is going through a dry time, and Jesus is saying, come to me. Come to me. Keep coming to me. Because I have got this living water, the Holy Spirit, to give to you. Verse 38, it says, Jesus says, whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him. You know, if you've got a pond, you probably have to put more water into it from time to time. You have to clean it out, because otherwise it can become stagnant. But Jesus is saying, the Holy Spirit is not to be stagnant. The Holy Spirit, does not remain stagnant in you. The Holy Spirit will flow from within, which means the Holy Spirit wants to fill you and flow from within you and flow out to all of those around you. The Holy Spirit is a moving, living person, one of the Trinity. And he wants to fill you and flow from within you and flow out to those around you. You're giving life to you, giving you joy, and reaching out to other people. Do you know, I just love hearing stories where people have been truly changed when they've met someone and they knew that there was something very different about this person. And what it is the Holy Spirit flowing from within that person, flowing out and touching those who are around them. And the Holy Spirit in us should be allowing him to flow through us, reaching out. You know, or even if they didn't know my name, come to me and say, Pete. No, they don't, because I'm saying they don't know my name. But if nobody has ever come to me and said, there is something about you that is reaching deep into my heart and I really want to change. I really wish I could come before you and say, it happens every day. I walk down the street and to my knowledge, it has never happened. But I'm longing for the Holy Spirit to flow from within me out to those around. And that is what I'm praying for. And Jesus wants us to come to him. That's what he says, come to me. Because he has a whole life to give us. A complete package of joy and peace and love that he wants to give us. And it's all wrapped up in the gift of the living water, the Holy Spirit, which will flow out of us. I'm going to ask you, have you ever received the Holy Spirit? Have you ever gone to the feet of Jesus and said, Lord Jesus, I really want to belong to you. I'm giving you myself. Please come, please fill me. I want that living water to flow from within me and flow out. And I want all that the Holy Spirit does in the lives of people. I'm asking, I want him to do it in me. And I'm coming to you, Jesus. Or are you someone who just comes to church from time to time? Or perhaps regularly, but you have never really given your life to Jesus and asked him to fill you with the Holy Spirit and opened yourself up to receive the Holy Spirit. Today could be the day that you do that for the very first time. Or it may be that you're feeling a little bit short of the Holy Spirit, you see, because we do leak. You know, the disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit on that Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. But then in Acts chapter 4, they go back to the house and they're filled with the Holy Spirit again. And we do leak. And it may be today where you're feeling a little bit dry and you know that you need that living water to flow from within you. And you want to come before Jesus and say, Lord Jesus, I'm here and I'm open and I'm asking you to fill me again with your Holy Spirit. It may be that during this time, what you'd like to do is to turn the camera off and remain muted and time for you to pray. Maybe you want to get down on your knees, which is why it may be that you want to turn the camera off. And maybe you want to lie down on the floor. But it may be that today you want to ask Jesus in your life for the first time and say that you want that living water. It may be that today you just want to lie there with your arms open wide and say, Lord Jesus, I'm asking you to fill me again with your Holy Spirit for the glory of your name, because this is why the Holy Spirit comes. This is why the Holy Spirit fills us, for the glory of the name of the risen Jesus, for no other reason. And it would be for that reason that you are asking the Holy Spirit to fill you. So it's up to you now, whatever you do during this time. As I say, please remain on mute. But as I say, maybe that you wanted to turn the camera off for just a moment or two. Well, you pray and you respond as you need to this morning. Father God, we are your children. And we want to pray this morning that your church here in Gretton will be filled with your Holy Spirit and flow from within us as a church for the glory of your name. Amen. It may be that you know that the Holy Spirit has touched you this morning and you want to tell me about it, then please do. I would love to hear. I really would. So please do. And just continue to pray for the Holy Spirit to fill you, for that living water, for the glory of the name of Jesus Christ. We're going to listen to another song now. This is another one that you'll know. We sing it from time to time at church, but it is a great one to close a service with. And so if you want to sing along, please do make sure you're muted. But it is, There Is a Higher Throne.
Promised grace, salvation.
Heavenly Father, as we go through today, may we know your loving parenthood. May we know that you're with us. May we celebrate that today, as well as celebrating our own fathers, earthly fathers. But we do thank you for who you are, and that we are part of your family. And we come to you, and we long for that living water to flow through us for the glory of your name. So may we serve you and be close to you throughout today and every day. Amen.